Good afternoon. Can I remind members that COVID-related measures are in place and that face coverings should be worn while moving around the Chamber and the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is portfolio questions. This portfolio is education and skills. If any member wishes to ask a supplementary question, they should press their request to speak buttons or put an R in the chat function if they're joining us online during the relevant question. And question number one is Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Do ask the Scottish Government how many unemployed teachers there currently are in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
We are firmly of the view that we will need all possible teaching resources at our disposal to compensate for any loss of learning suffered since the start of the pandemic, as well as to bring much needed resilience to the education system at this challenging time. Since the start of the pandemic, we've provided £240 million of additional investment specifically for the recruitment of more education staff. In addition to this funding, we are providing local authorities with permanent funding of £145.5 million per year to support the recruitment of extra teachers on permanent contracts.
Mr. Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for that reply, but I have to tell her that this is still a major problem. And over the last 24 hours, I have had a flood of complaints from newly qualified teachers. One was so desperate, she was spending £400 a month travelling from Edinburgh to Glasgow for a teaching job. Another had retrained to become a teacher, but is now back with her former employer. One said, "I've had enough. My mental health has been affected. My life is on hold until I get a permanent post, but there are none for any of us." The Education Secretary's complacency is crushing the careers of newly qualified teachers. When is she going to get this sorted?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as the member knows, the responsibility of the recruitment of staff is directly with local authorities and does not sit with national government. National government's responsibility is around funding, and I've detailed in the answer to Alec Cole-Hamilton, particularly around the baselining of funding that we provided to local authorities to ensure that local authorities can recruit extra teachers on permanent contracts. Figures published do show that teacher numbers are increasing, indeed, for the fifth year in a row. There are now more teachers than at any time since 2008, and the ratio of pupils to teachers is at its lowest since 2010. We are undertaking firm action on this. I've demonstrated that, I think, in my original answer, and we will continue to do so to support our valued teachers at this time. As I said, we know that their skills and expertise are required to support our young people during this difficult time.
There's a number of supplementaries. I hope to get all of them in, so brief questions and answers if possible. Evelyn Tweed, firstly.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And in a similar vein, to ask the Scottish Government for an update in progress on recruiting more teachers to Scotland schools.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the additional £240 million that I mentioned in my original answer to Alec Cole-Hamilton has already been provided and has supported the recruitment of more than 2,200 additional teachers and over 500 support staff. The permanent funding of £145.5 million per year that we are providing to baseline local authority funds will allow the recruitment of even more additional teachers on permanent contracts. And as I said in my answers to Alec Cole-Hamilton, that does mean now that we have more teachers than any time since 2008.
Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the number of teachers looking for employment and the additional roles being recreated, does the Cabinet Secretary share my concern that Dumfries and Galloway Council are telling parents, particularly in smaller rural schools, that they may have to cut back on teacher numbers and strictly enforce ratios?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, every council will be receiving additional funding from the Scottish Government, as I've laid now in my answers to two members. That would include Dumfries and Galloway Council. And I would encourage the council to ensure that that additional funding that has been baselined into a settlement is used to ensure that permanent staff are recruited.
And Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. Excuse me. Can I thank Minister for confirming that the 1,000 new teachers and the 500 pupil support assistants that were announced on August the 2nd have indeed been employed? Can she confirm out of that number how many are qualified to work with ASN children?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as the member will know, that there are children who all teachers will work with that will have additional support needs. There are particular arrangements and the determination that this government has to ensure that we are supporting children with additional support needs further in our work with the colleagues in the Scottish Green Party, and I'll certainly keep Mr Whitfield up to date on the work that we're undertaking on that.
And Willie Rennie.
It is truly astonishing that the Education Secretary, after months of asking, still doesn't know how many unemployed teachers there are in this country. She is the Education Secretary. She should know the answer to this. She can't simply pass the buck to council. So when is she going to get a grip of this situation and actually improve the careers of teachers rather than crushing them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, again, Presiding Officer, I can only go through some of the figures I have just detailed about the action that, that has been taken since I became Education Secretary, including the baselining of the funding to ensure that we have permanent contracts that are available. That, of course, is a matter for local authorities, but local government has been provided the funding for those additional posts through the national government's work, and we are determined to continue that work. Of course, we have a commitment during this Parliament for the employment of at least 3,500 additional teachers. That's over and above the additional 1,400 teachers that were recruited during the pandemic. This government has taken action and will continue to take action to support our teachers and young people.
Question number two, Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government for an update on the Discover Cyber Skills Programme.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Discover Cyber Skills Programme was delivered by Skills Development Scotland between September 2017 and March 2021. The purpose of the programme was to build young people's, parents and teachers' understanding of good cyber practice and also to inspire young people into cyber security careers. Over the 4 years of the programme, SDS engaged with over 130,000 pupils in schools from every local authority in Scotland. And in addition, the programme provided upskilling to teachers through the development of a toolkit to support the delivery of cyber skills sessions to young people.
Tess White.
Figures show that there has been a 29% decrease in pupils taking computing sciences at higher level between 2016 and 2020. As well as a significant decline in computing teachers over the past decade. What action is the Scottish Government taking to increase uptake in this area to ensure we have a pipeline of talent in place to meet serious challenges like cybercrime, which has nearly doubled in the last year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I concur with the direction that the member is taking with her question to say that this is a very important issue, and we do need to ensure that we have the young people with the adequate skills in this area, and part of that is, of course, around teachers that are qualified in this area. The latest data shows that there was an increase in the number of teachers that have computing when compared to what was there in 2019. We know that there are, of course, more work to do on that issue, but that's exactly why we are taking forward work, for example, from the Logan Review to ensure that we are moving forward with this agenda.
Supplementary, Michael Mara.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think it's a very pertinent question. I have regular representations from businesses in Dundee who tell me that they could create hundreds of jobs in the city were the sufficient skills available locally in the labour pool. They just don't exist. I would commend the work of local universities like Abertay, but unfortunately at Abertay they can't actually use computing as a compulsory subject because so few state schools now offer higher computing in their schools. What concrete action can be taken immediately to address the deficit that's been identified and to actually make sure that we can get people who are, instead of in the first year of their courses, having to relearn the subject they should have learnt at school?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think I mentioned in my original answer, or perhaps my supplementary answer, the work that was going on following the Logan Review. There was a number of pieces of that were to do with schools. I've, of course, recently met with Mark Logan and Senior Fitzgeralds to discuss that work. We're due to have further meetings in the next few weeks about those proposals and how we can take that forward. There's a number of areas of action that are are already being undertaken by Education Scotland and other agencies in this area. But I do recognise it is something that we do need to do more on, and that's exactly why I'll have continued engagement with Mark Logan and others interested in this area.
Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Both Skills Development Scotland and the General Teaching Council have previously noted the value of bringing computer experts into the classroom to upskill both teachers and pupils on issues such as cybersecurity. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise whether the Scottish Government has any plans to bring further industry experts into school on other broader tech-related subjects?
Cabinet Secretary.
One valuable form of expertise is from industry voices who can work with schools to inspire young people and to support the teachers. So there are a number of partners already working with schools to introduce industry skills and to support this work. Of course, Skills Development Scotland is heavily involved and has established a framework which brings agencies together to help them tackle that challenge. It is an important area of work that we are keen to do more on, to make sure that schools have close relationships and discussions with industry and with local and national businesses, and something Skills Development Scotland is very heavily involved in.
Thank you. Question 3 is not lodged. Question number 4, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to incorporate the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child into Scots law.
Minister Claire Hawhey.
We remain committed to the incorporation of the UNCRC to the maximum extent possible as soon as practicable. We are considering the implications of the Supreme Court judgment and how best to take forward incorporation. We are undertaking targeted engagement with stakeholders and options before final decisions are made. Options also need careful consideration to ensure that they address areas found to be out with competence, deliver the UNCRC policy and avoid further challenge. The Deputy First Minister will come back to Parliament in due course with our proposals. And whilst the Supreme Court judgment means that the UNCRC bill cannot receive royal assent in its current form, the majority of the work in relation to the implementation can and is continuing.
Ms Boyer.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? This issue is too important for there to be further delays. Every day that passes is another day where these rights are not enshrined in law. And I know that the Scottish Youth Parliament are understandably concerned about getting these rights in place. We've also issues within Scotland, such as our National Qualifications Agency, being subject to statutory action from the EHRC, which shows how vital these rights are. So when can this Parliament expect a timetable for a revised bill, and how soon is in due course?
Minister.
Thank you very much. I think it's fair to say that the Scottish Government are bitterly disappointed that this bill has been delayed, but we remain committed to the incorporation of UNCRC to the maximum extent possible and as soon as practicable. We are committed to a 3-year UNCRC implementation programme in collaboration with public authorities, children and young people, during which we're investing £4 million a year to support a fundamental shift in how children's rights are respected, protected and fulfilled in Scotland. So the work is progressing, and as I said in my original answer, the Deputy First Minister will return to Parliament with her proposals.
I've got a number of supplementaries. I would hope to get them all in, but brief supplementaries, please. David Torrens, firstly.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree that the straightforward and quickest way of incorporating the United Nations Convention on the Rights of a Child would have been for a bill which this Parliament unanimously voted for, receiving royal assent without objections from UK Government law officers?
Minister.
Yes, I do. I agree with that, Mr Torrens. And the Supreme Court judgment makes it plain that we are constitutionally prohibited from enacting legislation that the Scottish Parliament unanimously decided was needed to enshrine and fully protect the rights of our children. This Government believes that the children of Scotland deserve to have the commitments made to them fulfilled, and our determination is to do that, and to do that is undiminished. It is with urgency that we are carefully considering the implications of the judgment and how best to take forward this important legislation.
Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It has been over a month since the Scottish Government was told its bill went beyond the powers available to the Scottish Parliament. Taxpayers' money is being spent so the SNP can play cynical constitutional games with children's rights. Therefore, can I ask the Minister whether she believes that using almost £200,000 of taxpayers' money to further their nationalist agenda is appropriate use of public funds?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Can we listen to the response, please? all sides. Minister.
Perhaps the member, being a new member, is not aware that her party also voted for that legislation. It was voted for unanimously by this Parliament.
I've asked for a bit of quiet so we can hear the response. Minister, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's very difficult when you have the opposing benches shouting over you. This Parliament is committed to ensuring that the children of Scotland, their rights are upheld and respected. And we will continue to work to make sure that that happens.
Thank you, Minister. Both front benches were engaged in shouting over others, so could I ask for a bit of courtesy for speakers and could a final brief supplementary, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
The government talks about moving with urgency and being bitterly disappointed, and yet it could foresee that this would have happened when Whitehall officials in the process of the bill had informed government officials there were problems. We were never told on any of these benches, on opposition benches to the left or right of these problems during the transit of the bill. They could have been easily remedied at that stage too. Will the government now take this opportunity to explain to the children of Scotland why they withheld that information?
Minister.
I'm not quite sure what point Mr Cole-Hamilton was making there, as he seemed to be asking several questions which I'm not quite sure what he was actually wanting me to respond to. The duty of this government is to ensure that children of Scotland have their rights respected. We will continue to work at pace to ensure that the will of this Parliament is upheld.
Question number five, Liz Smith.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what measures are in place to protect the autonomy of Scotland's universities.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
The autonomy of Scotland's universities is protected through their legal status as independent charitable bodies. The Higher Education Government Scotland Act 2016 also expanded the statutory definition of academic freedom, requiring our universities to aim to uphold the academic freedom of persons engaged in teaching or the provision of learning or research at the university.
Liz Smith.
Could I thank the Minister for that reply, and I'm sure he agrees that both university autonomy, which of course includes the academic freedom that he's just referred to, has been part of the success of the university system for hundreds of years, precisely because it protects institutional diversity and specialisation. The system reflects the likes of the Royal Conservatoire, Rural College and Glasgow School of Art. Does the Minister, however, accept that recent developments with regard to free speech in the university system, both at UK and Scottish level, threaten to undermine the concepts of autonomy and academic freedom? And will he explain to Parliament what action the Scottish Government is taking to ensure that university autonomy is never diminished?
Minister.
Well, the first point I would make, I understand why the question is being asked, but in my experience, I've not had a single institution contact me or a single academic contact me expressing concerns about what the system here in Scotland is operating to. Our responsibility, of course, is to ensure that we enshrine and protect the autonomy of institutions and indeed academics. That is enshrined in the Higher Education Government Scotland Act 2016. We expect institutions to adhere to that. Of course, the definition sets out that academic freedom includes the freedom within the law to hold and express opinions, question and test established ideas or receive wisdom, develop and advance new ideas or innovative proposals or present controversial or unpopular points of view. Our universities should be able to do that, and I see nothing that encumbers them from being able to.
Question number six, Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to ensure that the education curriculum provides pupils with sufficient skills to build a digital economy.
Cabinet Secretary.
Curriculum for excellence, experiences and outcomes for the technologies have been reviewed to ensure that all young people are learning up-to-date computing and digital skills in both primary and secondary schools. In addition, the Government has committed to fully implementing the Scottish Technology Ecosystem Review carried out last year by Mark Logan. Part of that review is the Scottish Teachers Advancing Computing Science Initiative, which was announced in our programme for government. This will run for and by computing science teachers, helping them to share best practice in computing science across all schools, promoting digital sector career opportunities and developing innovative teaching materials to be used for extracurricular computing clubs.
Ms Gosell.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Official figures have revealed that there were 766 computing science teachers responsible for 25,000 pupils in Scotland in 2008. But by 2020, there was 595 teachers educating fewer than 10,000 pupils, and less than 2,000 of those were female. What action has been taken to address the gender divide in the computer science studies?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, some of the discussions we've had in relation to a previous question touched on the work that the Logan Review has proposed, and as I said in my answer to that, there is already a great deal of action being undertaken by Education Scotland and other agencies. That includes our work to increase capacity for initial teacher education for computing science, support for coding clubs, and work to make it easier for schools to work with industry and bring industry voices into schools, as I also mentioned earlier. In response to the Logan Review, we are taking forward the STACS proposal to establish that teacher-led group. In relation to the gendered issue, which Ms Gozo quite rightly points out, there is a concern around that. There's a concern around this within all STEM areas. It's something which is in the Scottish Government's STEM education strategy that was produced, and it's something that we are determined to take further action on, as we did in that STEM strategy, to ensure that we can deal with that gender divide.
Supplementary, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. But the Cabinet Secretary agreed with me that investment in new facilities can also be a catalyst to improving both interest and skill set with regards to the digital economy, and which therefore makes the case for a new build West College Scotland campus in Greenock even more stronger.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I do agree that good quality learning opportunities which develop digital skills for our young people are vital at all stages in the education journey, including our colleges. I understand the Minister for Higher and Further Education visited the Greenock campus of West College Scotland with Mr McMillan in September and heard firsthand about the benefits that a new build campus could bring. Of course, he will be aware that the Scottish Funding Council have been working on a medium-term college estate strategy, which will help set priorities for investment should funding become available in the college sector, and we will work closely with the Funding Council in taking this forward.
Very briefly, Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. Could the Cabinet Secretary tell us how many high schools are offering higher computing this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
If the member would be agreeable, I will get to him in writing about the particulars on this issue. I'm not entirely sure that exact figure is in my briefing.
Thank you, Karen. Question number 7 has been withdrawn. Question number 8, Christine Graham. Can we have some assistance for Ms Graham? Expectation levels have risen to an almost unsustainable level.
Question number 8, Christine. Then I am doomed to failure, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what improvements it considers it has made in the delivery of education in Midlothian South, Tweeddale and Lauderdale.
Cabinet Secretary.
Schools and early learning and childcare settings across Midlothian, South Tweeddale and Lauderdale have benefited from a range of national and targeted initiatives to support the improved delivery of education. 1140 hours of high quality funded early learning and childcare, pupil equity funding and the £500 million of COVID funding to support education recovery and wellbeing will improve outcomes for children. At a local level, our £2 billion learning estate investment programme is funding a number of projects in Midlothian and the Scottish Borders, including replacement at Beeslack Community High School, Pennycook High School, Galashiels Academy and Peebles High School.
Christine Graham.
I thank Cabinet Secretary for a detailed answer. Following the admission after 4 years by Scottish Borders Council of liability for its failings in relation to some of my constituents' children attending Tweeddale's support unit, currently subject to an independent inquiry to which I shall be giving evidence, what improvements specifically has the Scottish Government made to support children with additional support needs and their families in my constituency and elsewhere in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
My thoughts are very much with the children and the families that have been affected by any issue of concern in any part of our education system. All children, of course, have the right to be cared for and protected from harm and to grow up in a safe environment in which their rights are respected and their needs met. I do note that Scottish Borders Council's announcement of an independent inquiry, and it would be inappropriate for me to comment further at this stage, but recognise Ms Graham's continued involvement and concern around this issue, and I give her my reassurance. I will keep a close eye on the proceedings on this and would be, of course, happy to discuss these issues with her in due course, should that be more appropriate once that inquiry has taken place.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions, and there'll be a slight pause as the front benches change.